To continue, we were discussing death sentence. So death sentence will be, sorry, we have come to the general exceptions, and insanity after insanity we'll be discussing intoxication. Intoxication again is of two types, voluntary intoxication and involuntary intoxication. And a person, if he has been intoxicated without his knowledge by some person, and he commits an offense during that, means when he has been intoxicated, involuntary intoxicated, he is excusable, he is not liable. But voluntary intoxication is not an excuse. He will be liable for any offense committed during voluntary intoxication. And next, following sections are consent, if any person's consents, and in that process, if he suffers any injury, nothing but you are done with voluntary non-fit injuria in torts. So, for simple example for this is, if a person, if two persons, if they participate in any wrestling or some sort of fight or a cricket game, whatever it may be, and a person is injured in that process, and the person causing the injury, he will not be liable because the consent of other person is there in that particular act. And one more important section in this general exception is right of private defense. Right of private defense, which includes both the defense of property and defense of body and property. Here, in this right of private defense, in English law, actually a person to exercise right of private defense, he must have some relation with the other person for whose, to rescue whom he is exercising this right of private defense. But under Indian law, even a person can exercise the right of private defense to help a stranger or to save a stranger from any offense or to save some person's property and all. So it is more wider in sense compared to the English law. So right of private defense means when there is a threat to the body or to the property, a person can use the reasonable force. And important here is reasonable force must be used, not excessive force. When excessive force is used, again, it is an offense. It comes under, again, exception to murder and all, exceeding right of private defense. So one important thing to be noted here is when a person wants to exercise his right of private defense of body or property, reasonable force must be used. So these are, in brief, the general exceptions. And if anyone is having any doubt, you can ask me in this chapter. So that if you are, after clarifying your doubts, I'll go to the next topic, abetment and criminal conspiracy. Is it clear, general exceptions, or you want me to repeat any topic in this general exception again? No doubts? Want me to continue with abetment? Can you hear me? Okay, so I'll continue with the next topic, abetment. Abetment sections 107 to 120 of Indian Penal Code deals with abetment. So what is abetment? Abetment means to encourage to commit an offense. So under section 107 of Indian Penal Code, there are three types of abetment. One is abetment by instigation. The second one is abetment by criminal conspiracy. And the third one is abetment by aid. So if one person instigates some other person to commit an offense, here the person committing the offense, he will be liable. Along with the person committing the offense, even the person who is instigating him, encouraging him also will be liable for abetment. So abettor, the person who is abetting is known as the abettor. And the person who has been abetted, here we'll not call him as abettee, we'll call him as the person abetted. both of them will be liable for the offense committed. So even abettor, not actually, here the abettor need not actually participate in the offense. Just if he encourages, or if he participates in the conspiracy to commit that particular offense, or if he gives any type of aid in that particular offense, means helping him financially or providing any weapons or any other means help needed to that particular person committing the offense, all this amounts to aid, and the person giving this aid also will be liable for abetment. So in most of the cases, the abettor, he will be given the same punishment as that of the particular, as the person who committed the offense. In certain offenses, the abettor will be given 1/4 or half of the punishment, depending upon the type of the offense committed. This has been clearly explained in this abetment chapter, from punishments from 109 to 120. And for abetment, we'll be having most, many of the cases, criminal conspiracy and for committing the offense and all, we can take examples of Rajiv Gandhi assassination, Indira Gandhi assassination. These cases we'll be discussing even in criminal conspiracy 120A and 120B. So here abetment, abettor, he can abet the offense in three ways. Just I'm telling you the gist of abetment in three ways. One, by instigation, that is by encouraging him to commit the offense. Second, by criminal conspiracy, means conspiring with the person who is committing the offense, means preparing a plan to commit that particular offense. And third, by giving help, that is aid. And one thing what you have to remember is, even if the person who is committing the offense is not capable by law of committing the offense, for example, a child, if he abets a child, one person abets a child to commit an offense, simple illustration I can give you for this. This abettor, he'll ask a child to mix poison in a sweet so that he can, so that a person, some person X will eat that sweet, and he want, this abettor want that person X to die eating that poison. So here, now, tell me, you can message me, tell me whether the child is liable or not if he mixes the poison and some person dies after eating the poison. I need a quick answer. What is the liability of the child? Say, for example, he is below 10 years of age. He has been abetted, he has been instigated by a person to mix poison in a sweet. So one student, she has given the answer that liable. But just now we have discussed under general exceptions chapter, act of a child. Okay. So one more answer is below 7 years, not liable. Very good. So he is below 10 years of age. Just now I told you below 10 years means above 7 years. So here again, depending upon the maturity of that particular child, maturity level of that particular child, if he is capable of understanding, he will be liable. If he is not capable of understanding, he is not liable. So here, whether the child, if he is not having that mature intellect, he is not liable. But the person who is instigating him, he will be liable for abetment, irrespective the child is punished or not. Similarly, with a person of unsound mind, the same offense, if this person, abettor, instigates a person of unsound mind to commit an offense, So, one more illustration I'll give you. Abettor, he will ask a person of unsound mind to go and light fire to a house. So, because of this instigation, this person of unsound mind, he goes and he lights fire to a house. Now tell me, what is the liability of the person of unsound mind and the abettor? Whether both of them are liable, or only abettor is liable, or only the person who lights fire is liable? I need the answer. Did you get me? So I'm not getting any answers here. So under section 84 of, abettor is liable. And unsound mind person not liable. Okay, so avatar is liable for instigating, but unsound mind person is not liable. He can claim exemption under Section 84 of the Indian Penal Code, but he has to prove that while committing that particular act, he's not in a position to understand what he is doing. The burden of proof lies on the unsound person. So here, abettor, whether the my intention here is to make it clear to you, it is not necessary that the person who is committing the offense must he be capable by law of committing an offense. He may be a child or he may be a person of unsound mind. It is immaterial who committed the offense, but the abettor will be liable. And one more thing what you have to remember here is, even if the act abetted is not committed, the abettor will be liable. So for the offense of abetment, it is not necessary that the act abetted must be committed. Abetment itself is an offense. The act need not be committed. So is it clear, abetment? So that I'll go to the next topic, criminal conspiracy. So many of them, they have given right answers. Person with unsound mind, he is not liable and all. Very good. So shall I move to the next topic, criminal conspiracy? So for this criminal conspiracy, the relevant sections under Indian Penal Code are Section 120 capital A and 120 capital B. Initially, this chapter was not there in the Indian Penal Code. Later, they have introduced this particular chapter. And under this particular, only two sections are there, 120A and 120B. So 120A, for this offense of criminal conspiracy, minimum two persons must be there, because a person cannot conspire with himself. So minimum two persons, there may be more than two persons, but the minimum requirement is two persons. And here, if they prepare a plan to commit an offense, two persons, they sit together, they prepare a plan, and in furtherance of that particular plan, if they commit offense, they will be liable under Section 120A. And the punishment is 120 capital B. And there are many cases, almost all the, means majority of the cases which we come across, just now previous, means while discussing abetment, I have discussed Indira Gandhi assassination case, Rajiv Gandhi assassination case, or Mumbai terror attacks, and parliament attack case. All these cases involve the concept of criminal conspiracy. Without conspiracy, criminal conspiracy, it is highly impossible to commit such type of offenses. So if we take Rajiv Gandhi assassination case, so all of you know that in Rajiv Gandhi assassination case, the main conspirator was LTTE Prabhakaran, and he so his intention was to kill Rajiv Gandhi. So instead of he directly executing his intention, he contacted some persons in Madras. At the time it was Madras, now we are calling it as Chennai. So they contacted some persons, few persons in Chennai, sorry, Madras. And those persons, in turn, they contacted Nalini, Tanu, Sivarasan, etc. And one thing what you have to clearly understand here is, Prabhakaran, he is not directly in contact with Nalini, Sivarasan and group. So in between, there are some other persons who were whom he contacted. They in turn contacted these persons who have executed this particular plan to kill Rajiv Gandhi. So here in criminal conspiracy, it is not necessary that the person, means all the conspirators, they have to sit together and they have to discuss. So the initially who have, means the person who actually having the intention of killing Rajiv Gandhi, he need not be in direct contact with the persons who have executed the plan. So there may be a series of acts, and in this process of series of acts, these persons, they need not be in contact, all of them, they need not be contact with one another, but all of them, they will be liable for criminal conspiracy. The same punishment will be given to all the persons who has executed the plan, and the person who have abetted and the persons who are in that particular series of acts. So these are the classic cases for this criminal conspiracy. You can go through the facts of the case. You can Google and check out all these assassinations cases, Indira Gandhi assassination and Rajiv Gandhi assassination, Mumbai terror attacks and Afzal Guru case and all. So is it clear, criminal conspiracy, or any doubts in this topic, criminal conspiracy? Is it clear? Okay. So, next chapter in this second unit is offenses against public tranquility from 141 to 160. So, main offenses under this particular chapter are: one is unlawful assembly, the second one is rioting, and third one is affray. So, unlawful assembly. Under section 141, they have IPC, they have given clear definition of what is unlawful assembly. So the minimum requirement for an unlawful assembly is five or more persons. So minimum requirement is 5 persons. So there may be any number of persons above 5 persons, but if the number is less than 5 persons, okay, so one student is asking about sedition. Let me first complete this. By mistake, I have ignored that particular chapter. First let me complete this unlawful assembly so that I'll go to sedition, right? Okay, so unlawful assembly, there are a minimum 5 persons. If the number is less, it does not come under unlawful assembly. And assembly, you know, all of you know, you are well aware the provisions in the constitution. Right to form assembly, it is one of the fundamental rights. So right to form assembly is not an offense, but where the object of that particular assembly, when they have assembled to commit an offense, then only it comes, then it is an offense under IPC. So here, why they have gathered, why the people came together, why they are forming an assembly, means they have given under 5 clauses have been given under 141. First one is, I'll just tell you what, in an order I'll give you what are the 5 clauses here. First one is to overawe by criminal force or show of criminal force the central or any state government or parliament or any legislature. Here overawe. Overawe means by the act of this particular assembly, the government is shocked, stunned, overawe. The meaning of overawe is they are in a shock or stunned. You know the meaning of shock or stunned, whatever it may be. So here, the act, this unlawful assembly, by their act, they are making the government, whether it may be central government or the state government, they are causing a shock to the government. And the second one is to resist the execution of any law or of any legal process. So resist the execution of any law or of any legal process. Simple example I can tell you, to resist any legal process. Police officer, on a warrant, he can arrest a person. When a police officer is going to a particular person and he want to execute a warrant, this group of people, means minimum 5 people, they are obstructing a police officer in executing the warrant. So here, this also amounts to unlawful assembly. And the third one is to commit any mischief or criminal trespass or any other offense. So this group of people, their intention is to commit criminal trespass. Criminal trespass is entering unlawfully into a land or building or a property of other person. Later, when we are dealing with property offenses in detail, we'll be discussing what is criminal trespass. So here, just unlawful entry. Anyhow, you are having an idea about trespass. Already you have done with trespass in thoughts. Nothing but unauthorized entry or unlawful entry into any premises. So here, this group of people, they are entering into other person's property to commit an offense. Whatever may be the intention of entering into other's property, maybe to intimidate them or to commit an offense, to commit theft or robbery or dacoity, whatever may be the reason they are entering into other property, or to commit mischief. Mischief we'll be discussing under section 425 of IPC. So this is one of the reasons of this unlawful assembly. And fourth one is by means of criminal force or show of criminal force to take or obtain possession of property or deprive any person of any property, possession of any property. So here, this members of the unlawful assembly, what are they doing, what are they trying to do is, they want to take the possession of property from some other person by showing force, criminal force, by using criminal force. And again, criminal force also, again, we'll be discussing in later under section 349 is force and 350 is criminal force. So we'll discuss in detail later. But here, they want to obtain this minimum 5 persons, they, means these persons belonging to the unlawful assembly, they are obtaining the possession, or they are depriving any person of the possession. Here, possession includes even possession, right to incorporeal property, right to weigh and all. And lastly, by means of force or show of criminal force, they are compelling any person to do what he is not legally bound to do, or omit to do what he is legally entitled to do. Always remember, in IPC, act includes omission. So, act, what is an act? Act means doing, committing an offense or doing an act prohibited by law, or illegal act, or against law. So first, what you have to understand is, what is an act, crime? I have given one for you, in your assignment I have given what is crime. Nowhere in IPC, crime has been defined. But we'll be taking the definitions given by different jurists. So one of the jurists, they have defined crime as an act of commission or omission. So act of commission, we can simply say an act or omission. So even we can say act of commission. What is commission here? Any act means against law, doing any act against law, or doing any act prohibited by law, any act which is illegal against law. And one more thing is omission. What is omission? Omission, we can explain as when a person is having any duty imposed by law and the person is not doing his duty, he's omitting his duty, then also it is punishable. It amounts to an offense. So, simple example I can give you for omission. A jailer, he's having a duty to take care of the prisoners in the prison. Here, if the jailer omits to provide food to one of the prisoners, so jailer, he may feel that this prisoner, he committed an offense, he committed some heinous offense, and so we need not give him food, let him die without giving food. Is that justifiable? No, because jailer, irrespective of the fact that he committed an offense and he has been sentenced in prison, the jailer's duty is to provide him food. If necessary, provide him with medicines and give him the treatment if necessary. Provide him with all the necessary treatment. So, if he jailer omits his duty by not providing providing food to the prisoner, and the prisoner dies of starvation, the jailer will be liable for omission. So, similarly, there will be many other examples, even a police officer not doing his duty. And here, one main thing what you have to remember here is, omission is where a person has a duty imposed by law. When he does not do his duty, it comes under omission. So in this fifth clause, here, by means of criminal force or show of criminal force, to compel any person to do what he is not legally bound to do, means this group of people, they are creating fear to a person, and they are making him to do a thing which he is not bound by law to do, means against law, means they are threatening him to do an act which is against law. I can explain you with a simple example here, simple illustration here. Suppose if you want to construct a house, you have to take permission from the concerned officer in the GHMC. So here, if it is according to the norms, that particular officer, he has to give permission to that particular building. The plan or design has to be sanctioned by that particular officer. But these people, they have prepared the plan against the rule, and they are threatening that particular officer to sanction that particular plan so that they can construct the house. So what are they doing here? They are compelling that particular person to sign, to approve that plan against law. If they, that particular plan is according to the norms, means the particular, you know, all of you know that while constructing a house or means apartments, whatever it may be, setback and everything is prescribed in law. So according to that, they have to construct, the plan has to be prepared. But here, this plan is not according to that prescribed norms. But they are forcing that particular officer to sign that, to approve that particular plan. And here, not a single, but to come under this unlawful assembly, a group of persons, that is minimum 5 persons, they are insisting him to approve the plan. And again, the same clause, they have given show of criminal force to compel any person to do what he is not legally bound to do, or omit to do what he is legally entitled to do. So, to do what he is not legally bound to do, I have explained you with an example. To omit to do, we can take the example of a police officer. Here, this group of people, they are compelling a police officer not to arrest a person. Here, the police officer is authorized to arrest, sometimes with warrant, sometimes without warrant, a person on a reasonable suspicion. Then, when this group of persons, they are not, they are compelling the police officer not to arrest a person. Here, group, again and again, I'm telling you that it is minimum 5 persons must be there. So, this group, when they are compelling a police officer not to arrest a person, it amounts to an offense under this particular chapter. So, hope you understood what is unlawful assembly. So, here, almost all offenses have been included because they have explained overawing the government and execution, they are resisting the execution of any law, and to commit a mischief or criminal trespass or any other offense, all this have been included. So any group of persons, if they are doing anything against law, it becomes an unlawful assembly. And actually, here there is a doubt, Naveen Kumar. But now, nowadays, after everything is right as per law, also they object, ma'am. Okay. So, this is a different aspect. What you are saying is, so there are various reasons for that. All of you know that. But here we cannot discuss that, why they are objecting that. Entirely, that is a different topic. Okay. So, because we are, this is a public, this thing, we cannot go into that. All of you know that, what is the main reason for that. And so, unlawful assembly means committing any offense against law by group of persons. And coming to rioting, section 146 of, punishment for this, being member of an unlawful assembly, they have given under 143, every member, whether they have committed, means actively participated in that particular act or not, being a member itself is punishable. All of them, they will be liable. And coming to rioting is nothing but when this group of people in an unlawful assembly, they use violence or force, it amounts to rioting. So in the material given to you, I have given clearly an equation, unlawful assembly plus force or violence is equal to rioting. Means this group of people, when they have, when they are using force or violence, it amounts to rioting. Very simple. And one more thing what you have to remember is with regard to this unlawful assembly is, initially an assembly may be lawful, but later it may become unlawful. So how? All of you know that there will be many processions. It may be a religious procession or some other procession, and there is a process for this procession to carry on this procession. They have to take permission from the police, and after taking permission from the police, they can carry on the procession. So when a procession is going on, and the authority here who has given permission, if they receive information that this procession is about to violence may take place in this procession, they will order this members of this procession to disperse. In spite of the dispersal orders given by the authority, if they continue in the procession, this procession initially, which was lawful in the sense they have taken the required permission from the authority and they are continuing in the procession, it becomes unlawful after an order has been given for dispersal of that particular assembly. So these members, if they continue in this unlawful assembly after the dispersal orders, all of them again they will be liable as being member of the unlawful assembly. So an assembly, initially it may be lawful, later it may become unlawful. So when it becomes unlawful, all the members, they will be liable for this unlawful assembly. Hope it's clear. And one more offense in the, and other related sections are there in this particular chapter. And unlawful assembly, carrying arms in the unlawful assembly, carrying deadly weapons in unlawful assembly. Depending upon all this, punishment have been provided in this particular chapter. And lastly, one more offense in this chapter is affray. Affray is nothing but fight in a public place. Two or more persons, if they fight in a public place, it becomes an affray. So here, the essential ingredients of this particular offense is minimum two persons, and there must be a fight, and it must be in a public place. I'm insisting that it must be in a public place. If it is in a private place, it does not come under this section, 159 FA, and punishment is 160. So these are the main, these three are the main offenses under this chapter, 141 to 160. So if you're having any doubts regarding this, you can ask me. So here, rioting. Here there is one question from Akash. So can unlawful assembly and rioting be charged separately, or it can be conjoined as such? So here, generally they can rioting punishment. Section 146 is rioting, and I'll tell you the punishment for rioting. Under section 147, punishment for rioting is maximum 2 years or with fine or with both. So while charging under section 147 of IPC, read with 149, that is common object. So instead of saying unlawful assembly, they will be filing charges as 147, read with section 149, that is common object. So common object means these members of this particular group, unlawful assembly, all of them, they are liable. So generally for common intention also, if a murder, already we have this common intention also, I have given you clearly the difference between common intention and common object in the material given to you. Common intention, section 34. So If two or more persons, if they commit any offense, I am explaining you what is common intention here. So common intention, when two or more persons, if they commit an offense, whatever may be their role, means to a smaller extent or to a larger extent, all of them, they are jointly and severally liable. Means jointly and severally liable means they will be given the same punishment. Three persons, or take for example four persons, they want to kill a person, they want to murder a person. A, B, C, they want to kill D. Here, A will go to D and call him. He'll say to D that, I want to talk to you, please come with me, and he'll take him to one place. And after going to that place, B will tie his hands and legs with a rope, and C will stab him. Now, what is the liability? Here the question is, what is the liability of A, B and C? So actually here, just A, what is the role of A? He called D to that particular place. Apart from that, he has not done anything. And B, just he tied his hands and legs. And C is the person who has actually stabbed him and caused the death of the person. Now, can you tell me what is the liability of A, B and C? Any one of you? What is the liability? All of them, they will be liable for murder, or only C will be liable for murder? Good. So Taruni, Thakur, all three are liable. All three are liable for murder. So here, section 302, read with section 34. 34, there is no punishment for 34. It's not a substantive offense. It is read with some other section. So here, 302, read with 34. Or some other section, read with 34. Clear? So all of them, they will be liable irrespective of their role, whatever may be their role, small to a smaller extent or to their larger extent. Similarly, here also, member of the unlawful assembly, all of them, they will be liable irrespective whether they have actually participated in that particular offense or not. Being member itself, they are liable. Clear or not? Is it clear? Here, Akarsh, one more question. He asked me one more question. His doubt is, whether it will amount to abetting. So, in common intention, one more essential ingredient is participation is must. Whereas in abetting, it is not necessary that the person abetted the abettor must participate in that particular offense. So here in the illustration given by me, there is participation of A, B also. So it comes under common intention. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
What if murder is done for a good cause? So Abhishek, I did not get you. So what if murder is done for a good cause? Good cause in the sense? And all are liable for the same punishment. Different punishments will not be given in the illustration given by me for common intention. All of them will be held liable for murder. Same punishment will be given to all the persons irrespective of their role. So in the material given to you, I have given you one case law. Post office case I have given you. Please go through that particular case. In that particular case, they have discussed when there was a robbery in a post office, one person, he was standing outside. So his contention was that, I have not actually participated in the crime. I was standing outside the post office. But all of them, they were given the same punishment. Akash, I did not get you. You asked me one question for a good cause, murder for a good cause. What is murder for a good cause? Abhishek, like if he is a terrorist. So, if they are causing the death of a terrorist, it does not come under murder. So, it is again a part of maintaining law and order. It is protecting. It is protecting the national security, maintenance of peace, law and order. It does not come under murder. So there will be no murder for a good cause. We cannot say if it is a murder, it is for a good cause. And terrorist, removing a terrorist or means causing the death of a terrorist or some other offender, it does not amount to murder. Okay, clear? Okay. So any other doubts, if you want any other, please ask me if you're having any other doubt. So if a murder is done under self-defense, it comes under right of private defense, general exceptions. He is not liable. And again, here you have to remember, always right of private defense, it must not be, it must be reasonable. A person cannot exceed his right of private defense. In criminal conspiracy and abetment, all of them, they will be, the means the abettor as well as the person who is committing the offense, both of them, they will be given the same punishment. In most of the offenses, only there are few offenses where the abettor will be given lesser punishment. Whereas in criminal conspiracy, all the conspirators and the person executing the plan, they will be given the same punishment. Here, they're asking doubts, so I'm giving answer to that. So, here one person is, even though all are liable, but punishment differs according to their role. One student is asking. So, irrespective of their role, that is what again and again I am repeating, irrespective of their role may be to a smaller or a greater extent, all of them, they are equally liable, they are jointly liable. Akash, in your question, only one would be liable and the other would be treated as accomplice. Actually, there is no clarity in your question. Accomplice means... madam will clear, means in evidence you'll be getting the term accomplice. Accomplice means co-accused. Means if more than one person, he commits an offense, minimum two. So the other person in that particular offense is an accomplice, or otherwise we can call him as co-accused. Both of them, they will be liable. Akarsh, he's saying only one would be liable and the other would be treated as accomplice. Accomplice means co-accused. Co-accused also will be given punishment. What if the murder is sanctioned by the state like encounter? So, encounter also, here remember, encounters, again, there are certain guidelines given by the Supreme Court for encounters, because most of the encounters which we come across, They are again, sorry to say, but some of them, they are fake encounters. So Supreme Court, they have given guidelines for encounter also many a times to the police department. So here encounter means when a person is absconding or he's running away, he want to escape. So police officer, when he want to, while exercising his power, means he is exercising his duty in good faith. Here remember, in good faith, if he want to catch hold of that person and there is no other means except to shoot that particular person. Again, there are certain rules here which they have to follow while firing at a person. But sometimes it may happen that while firing at a person, it may hit that particular, a bullet may hit the vital part of that particular person and he may die. And there are many rules for that. So here, there are rules for this encounter also. So here, for this, here again, Akarshan is asking, if murder is sanctioned by the state like encounter. So even encounters, just now I told you, even encounters also, they have to go according to the procedure, according to the rules. If they exceed their powers, it comes under exception to murders, exception to Section 300. So I have posted your material even on that particular topic. Please go through Section 300. There are five exceptions exceeding the right of private defense. First one is right of grave and sudden provocation. Second one is exceeding right of private defense. And third one is public servant exceeding his power. Please go through that. We'll discuss some other day in detail all those. Okay. So, one of the students, he posed a doubt that, he posted a doubt that in some cases, some persons, they will be given death punishment and some persons, they will be given lesser punishment and some will be acquitted. So here, coming to acquittal, if there is no, means sufficient evidence, I'll not say that there is no evidence at all, but there is no sufficient evidence. Initially, I told you that, in the beginning of this class, I told you that the prosecution, burden lies on the prosecution. The prosecution must prove beyond reasonable doubt the guilt of the accused. So, if the prosecution fails to prove, means fails to produce evidence against that particular person, he may be acquitted. That does not mean that that particular person has not committed that particular offense. It is the failure of the prosecution to prove beyond reasonable doubt the guilt of that particular person. Any other doubts? So here, what if murdered person's family does not file a case? One thing what you have to remember in criminal cases is, here, state, police will file a case. It is not necessary that the family, if it comes to the notice of the police, on behalf of the victim, the police, they will file a case. Here, compromise with the murderer. All offenses cannot be compromised. Once an affair has been filed, they cannot, even if they compromise also, there is a procedure. Again here, the case trial must be conducted in the court. All offenses cannot be compounded, and CRPC clearly it will be given that under section 320 of CRPC, which offenses can be compounded and which offenses cannot be compounded. And murder, section 302, these offenses cannot be compounded. Any other doubts? If the aid of the accused becomes government approver witness, so he'll become an accomplice. So his evidence based on his evidence will be taken in the court. He's an accomplice. So Durga Madam will discuss with you what is the weight of the accomplice evidence, whether based on the accomplice evidence a person can be convicted or not. So in some cases, accomplice, there will be an understanding between the prosecution and the accomplice. Here the understanding is, if the accomplice discloses the true facts, he will not be punished. In some cases, when there is no evidence, they cannot find some evidence, even in spite of investigation, rigorous investigation by the police officer also, they will not be in a position to get any lead in a particular case. So in such cases, they'll be taking the accomplice, they'll be approaching this accomplice, there will be an understanding between the accomplice and the prosecution. And here the understanding is nothing but if he discloses the two facts, he will be acquitted. And so in such cases, he will not be punished. So that is the defect in our system. Actually, because the burden lies on the prosecution, and the prosecution, they are not in all the many of the cases, they are not in a position to prove beyond reasonable doubt they are acquitted. The accused persons are being acquitted. And here, justice for family members means where, in few cases, the compensation is being given to the victims, even if the accused is being acquitted. Victims of rape, victims of acid attacks, under section 357 of CRPC, even if the accused is being acquitted, also compensation is being given to the victims. Not in all the cases, very few cases. So, evidence, madam, she is giving how to bring due justice to the victims. So we'll end the session here, and if possible, tomorrow I'll talk to Durga madam, and if possible, tomorrow also we'll be online, and rest of the topics which have posted the material, I can explain you. And before coming online, please go through the material and write down your doubts, and you can ask me tomorrow. Madam will continue. Right, what's going to be in the online? No, I'm in online, madam.